faithful God.
For the works you've Prayers for the 7th of June. Jesus was born in 1st century Palestine, a country under occupation by the feared and hated Romans. Palestine was important geographically and had been occupied by one major power after another for many centuries. Every time this happened, the Jews were exiled. The Jews began to hope for Messiah, who would come and save them from their enemies. The Roman occupiers imposed many restrictions on what Jews could do, including interference with mass gatherings, religious practice, and imposing lockdowns. One comfort for the Jews was found in the familiar words of Scripture, Psalms and prayers. Today, we live in unusual times that Jesus can easily understand. After all, he lived through similar circumstances. We too can gain comfort from familiar words and prayers. We would invite you to listen to and enjoy some of these familiar words and join with us at the end in saying the Lord's Prayer. The Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference, living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace. Take as Jesus did, this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it. Trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Amen.
Instrument of your peace. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, not so much to be understood as to understand, not so much to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we awake to eternal life. Amen.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Lead me. My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself, and the fact that I think that I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and I hope that I have that desire in all that I'm doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore I will trust you always. Though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death, I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen. Let us all join in saying the Lord's Prayer. our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Make me ready to do your will. Hello there. This week's reading is 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 to 9. I'm doing this as I walk in the dogs. Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that proven genuineness of your faith, of a greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor, and Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Amen.
Oh, with Pentecost just behind us, knowing that God is with us and God left his Holy Spirit in us to do his work using our hands and our feet and our minds and our hearts, we can do his work here on earth. In Peter, 1 Peter, he says, what a privilege it is to be born again. What a privilege to be born into God's family, spiritually born. Whatever family that you have been brought up in, whether it's been the best family ever or not, we have a new family. A family that is spread out in our towns, in all the different churches. They are our family, our brothers and sisters. In the neighbouring towns, in villages, in cities, all over this country and all around the world, we will find people who are like-minded, who love Christ, who want to work for him, who want to bring peace and order into this world of chaos, who want to bring the love of Christ. And so Peter says, what a privilege to be born again. And I hope you feel this too. That is a privilege to be part of God's family. A privilege to share with each other. A privilege to sing the songs that other Christians have written to inspire us, to encourage us. A privilege to read God's word and the many books that people have written about God's word to explain it to us so we too can understand the many mysteries that God has and wants to reveal to us. And our Almighty God in verse 5, our Almighty God, our Father protects us. That doesn't mean that we don't have any trials or tribulations or things don't go wrong. We protect our own children. We love our children. And even though God does watch us 24/7, we can't always watch our children and we can't always protect them from everything. And to protect them from everything will not be good for them. So God allows in our lives those things that he can use and will use, and God allows those things in our lives that we can handle. We may not feel we can handle them, but then we go to God, our Father, our Almighty Father. We cling to him and cry out to him. And every tear that we cry, he catches, it says in Psalms, in a bottle and keeps them because everything about us is precious. The pain that we go through, he shares with us. Jesus felt and knows what it feels like to be in every situation that we have ever been in. And the joy that we experience in this world, in this life with each other, as we celebrate together, God celebrates with us. Our Father is interested and knows and is part of everything we are, everything we do, and everything. And so with that in mind, we know that as we go through these earthly trials in verse 6 and 7 of Peter, he says, we need to endure. It's not a nice word to endure. It sounds a heavy word itself. But we will endure many trials. And they will be for a while. Not forever, for a while they will pass. And as we endure, as we cling to God, our Father, as we speak to Jesus, as the Holy Spirit gives us the strength, the protection, the endurance, the diligence, the understanding we need to endure, we will come out of these trials. But these trials are important to help us grow in our Christian faith, to help us grow in our understanding of the world around us, and also of God's love and care. Trials test our faith. How do we know if we are growing unless our faith is tested? How do we know if we are getting stronger? If you go to the gym and you work your muscles, how do you know your muscles are stronger unless you start lifting heavier things than you did before to know if you've got the muscles to do it? Well, our faith is like that in some ways. In our testing, it's an opportunity to put our trust in God, to rely on him, to rely on the calling that he has for us, to ask him for help and guidance, to work through these trials and problems together with God and come out stronger and in our faith and stronger in our character and who we are. Trials show that our faith is strong and pure, that our motivations, our character, our heart and our mind are all focused on God. And even though they may feel like fire at times, like every piece of gold that is tried by fire, the dross, the rubbish, the things that are not important will come to the surface. And God, with his loving care, will scoop all those things out of our lives that we release to him, that float to the top, that do not matter, so that we may be the purest in Christ we can be. And our faith, it says, is more precious to God than gold. Our faith is more precious to God than anything he has ever made. And as he works in us, he seeks for us to be the purest we can be, purer than gold. And so going back to verse 5 and 6, it talks about we have an inheritance. We are the children of God. We have something to look forward to. These trials maybe are difficult and hard, and we have to endure them, and they're only for a while, but we are looking forward to something even better that is ahead of us. We need to be truly glad as we look to the wonderful joy that is ahead of us, the joy of sharing with our families, God's family, and the celebration that we will receive there. The joy of eternal life. Jesus came, he died, he rose again, and we will have that same arising with him when he returns. We will have the same body as Christ. He's demonstrated to his disciples, this is what my body is like, and this is what you will have too. We'll be able to walk through walls. I don't know if that will be necessary or not in heaven. And we'll be able to eat boiled fish. I don't know if you like fish. But the joy is that we will have fellowship together, fellowship with God. We have a hope of salvation that is given to us the moment we say yes to God. The Holy Spirit works it out in our lives, in our everyday living, in every trial, in every joy. The salvation that God has placed in us that is more precious than gold is being worked out in our lives. And we will celebrate that together. We can celebrate it now here on earth. We can celebrate it with our family here on earth. We can celebrate that God is protecting our heart, our mind, our souls, our spirit. That whatever comes our way, we can face it with him. We can put our trust in God. We can put our hope in God. For he is with us. He loves us. And he will continue to fight for us, to work with us, and to reveal his love and light and goodness through us. So let's continue to love each other, to love God, and to love ourselves. Amen.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Of you are hungry for God? Are you hungry for Him?